Dave Marish, Sander Van Oker, Sylvia Chase, Dr. Carl Sagan, Thomas Hogan, Geraldo Rivera, Harold Hayes, and Robert Hughes.
I'm Hayes.
And I'm Hughes.
And Robert Hughes is not exactly a household name,
too
Hughes.
Right.
Where do you come from? Tell us about yourself. You're Australian.
Born in Sydney about 40 years ago. Started off as a journalist there, sort of art critic, political cartoonist, all-purpose literary grease monkey. Yeah.
And then where?
To Europe. Studied art in Italy for a few years and then moved to England and did some work for the BBC there and freelanced. And then I was hired out of there by Time magazine about 8 years ago and so came here.
Slipped into the country surreptitiously?
Yep, under a forged talent. Now, how about you? Where'd you get that fancy foreign accent, Hayes?
From North Carolina, Hughes. We all talk that way down there. I started there many years ago, came to New York about 25 years ago. Been a magazine editor a lot of the time, a lot of that time at Esquire. Wrote a book on East Africa in the last couple of years and been concerned about conservation.
Well, different work now. Let's get to it.
Tonight, Geraldo Rivera reports on how greyhound racing dogs get their taste for the chase. A grisly sport, but it has its fans.
I don't think there is one thing wrong with it in any way, shape, or form. We all try to do the right thing, be honest, and up here for a lot of fun.
5 years ago, Flip Wilson quit playing Geraldine to play father to his own kids. And tonight he tells 2020 how much more it hurt him than it did them.
It concluded with us saying, Daddy, when is enough? And that was it. She never cried. I never spanked her again.
Today's California primary could start Governor Jerry Brown on another bid for the White House if the tax revolt doesn't get him first. We'll be talking to him via satellite about the second time around.
It's probably presumptuous for anyone to run for president. It's not just a matter of what I want, it's what people want. And they can make very clear their judgment as to whether or not this makes sense or not.
Imagine a nuclear bomb built by one person. Sander Van Oker reports on what could happen in this country and what has already been threatened.
The design I got basically out of books. They didn't say this is the way it is. They gave explanations of how it should work, why certain things happen.
Today is the 10th anniversary of Robert Kennedy's assassination. The family is at Arlington Cemetery and will be there for a talk with Senator Ted Kennedy.
This wayward week began with a bang,
which resulted in one less Greek oil tanker. Engineers blasted the crippled ship right out of the English Channel to prevent an oil spill from fouling nearby beaches.
It was that kind of a week.
The fireworks began at the NATO summit conference in Washington, where Jimmy Carter blasted the Soviet Union and Cuba for meddling in Africa.
As I speak today, the activities of the Soviet Union and Cuba in Africa are preventing individual nations from determining their own future.
Yet to that, said Soviet President Brezhnev, who blasted Carter for meddling in Africa and turning the Cold War up to lukewarm.
Then Cuba got its licks in at the UN, where Castro's Vice President Carlos Rodriguez attacked U.S. policy. Afterwards, Rodriguez sideswiped Carter, too.
I could not like to call the President of the United States a liar. It is not my intention.
But he went straight ahead and called the president's man, Zbigniew Brzezinski, one anyway.
I believe that he is, for the sake of policy, telling false things.
Whatever happened at daytime?
Well, Hayes, maybe it went to the ballet, because for the first time since Castro came to power, the Cuban National Ballet is dancing in the U.S. at the Kennedy Center.
Now for the week's toppers.
The top album, according to Billboard, is Saturday Night Fever.
The top TV show this week, the USO tribute to Bob Hope.
The top novel, according to Publishers Weekly, is Bloodline by Sidney Sheldon.
And the top jock, Giants Mike Ivey, who belted a pinch-hit grand slammer to beat the Dodgers.
And that's the top rock, the largest diamond ever found in South Africa, $11 million worth. Gee, Hayes, all I've got is a pet rock.
And that's the bottom dollar, the new dollar coin.
Feminists want to replace Miss Liberty there with Ms. Susan B. Anthony here, the legendary suffragette.
But no matter whose face is on the coin, the dollar just ain't buying what it used to.
Inflation hit double figures last week, with meat prices out of sight.
And you can blame the hamburger for that. Farmers can't keep up with America's hunger for burgers.
Imagine living and dying to become a hamburger. Well, as we said, Hayes, another wayward week.
Tonight, Geraldo Rivera with a special report on how greyhounds are trained. What's special about it, Geraldo?
Harold, I don't believe that you have to be an animal crazy, so-called animal crazy, or even a vegetarian to believe that the way we treat animals is a reflection of the way we treat each other. In this case, the greyhound industry says that their dogs need live bait. This report will establish that that simply is not so. Now, it's kind of gruesome, so parents might want to take their children out of the room till it's over.
So let's have a look at it.
Greyhound racing traces its origins back to Cleopatra's time, and it calls itself the sport of queens. But historical pretensions aside, there's no doubt but that greyhound racing is big business. Last year, 20 million Americans bet over $2 billion at dog tracks like this one in Arkansas. And there's no doubt but that watching and wagering on the dogs running is an exciting way to spend a summer afternoon or evening. But I wonder how popular greyhound racing would be if racing fans knew just how those greyhounds were trained to chase that mechanical rabbit.
Hit him!
Run, 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 run! Run, run, run!
It's called coursing. C-O-U-R-S-I-N-G. And it's the grim side of greyhound racing. Our 2020 investigation has found that coursing is a common practice among most greyhound owners, training their dogs on live bait, wild jackrabbit.
The jackrabbit's good for nothing. It's a rodent, it's a pest. Only thing I'd say about a jackrabbit that's good for is to eat a farmer's crop up.
We do not think it's a senseless killing.
We don't want to see the jacks get killed. Nobody does, but those things happen.
Just like when you go to a foot race, a horse race, or one of these drag races where these people kill themselves, nobody never says a dang thing about it.
I don't think there is one thing wrong with it in any way, shape, or form. We all try to do the right thing, be honest, and up here for a lot of fun.
I want to live, live and let live. Although coursing is a traditional and widespread part of greyhound training, it happens out in the open only here. Once in the spring and again in the fall, the crowds gather at a track in central Kansas, just outside of Abilene. The historic town has two principal claims to fame. It's the boyhood home of President Dwight Eisenhower, and it's the headquarters of the National Greyhound Association. The participants in the week-long coursing event come from all over the country, and they come to blood their dogs. In theory, coursing is also a sport. The rabbit can escape if it can outrun the charging dogs and reach a sanctuary located at the far end of the track. In practice, the rabbits don't stand a chance. Most are killed during their first run. Those are the lucky ones, because the survivors are simply recycled until some pair of dogs finally get at them. The old-timers, who still make up a majority of the Greyhound Association, maintain that coursing is more than just a blood sport. They claim their animals simply won't run after the mechanical rabbits used at dog racing tracks unless they've had at least three or four real-life kills during training. If it's cruelty, they insist, then it's necessary cruelty. But many other greyhound owners disagree.
I do not believe in live bait.
Donnie Work runs a successful greyhound training operation near Modesto, California. He feels the use of live bait is actually counterproductive. Once the dogs chase live rabbits, he told us, they won't want to chase the mechanical rabbit at the track. His technique, using an old animal hide, is less expensive and more closely resembles the mechanical rabbits used at dog tracks. The use of live bait is illegal in California, but successful dog racers who could train their dogs elsewhere with live rabbits still bring their greyhounds to this California track to be trained. Pat Grosch is from Florida.
I don't raise a whole lot of greyhounds at one time, but I train them all here, and they all do very well at the track. The dogs love to run. It's their instinct to run, and at home, my son trains the dogs for me on his motorcycle, and they'll run after him on his motorcycle, and a motorcycle doesn't look any more like a rabbit than anything you can think of, and they sure love chasing him. And they come here and they'll chase whatever you put out there for them to run after. They run after anything that moves.
Another controversial aspect of greyhound racing is the way some dog owners treat their dogs. Here in Kansas, for instance, racing greyhounds lead a dog's life. Unpromising pups are destroyed at birth. Many dogs are injured during their first year of training and are destroyed. Most greyhounds are not allowed to make it to middle age. Greyhound owners don't feed losers. Why, they say, should we pay to keep a dog alive that can't make money? The Humane Society of the United States objects to greyhound racing, and especially to coursing. Society investigator Franz Donsler.
It involves not only the exploitation of animals, but it's brutal, it's senseless, it serves no purpose whatsoever as far as we're concerned. Last year, I saw a group of, I believe it was a sixth grade class that came out. The teacher actually brought them here as a field trip experience to see coursing. Kids were there, right there by the fence, and they were watching this entire process of coursing. They were watching bringing the dead rabbits, and sometimes they weren't even dead, throwing them in barrels. The rabbits we see here today are not from Kansas. These are imported from other parts of the country, primarily Texas. The reason they do that is because there's no rabbits left in Kansas. They've killed them all away. That's why they have to bring them in from out of state. And to suggest that it's they're doing the farmer a service by getting rid of rabbits is pure nonsense.
The Humane Society attempted to stop the Abilene coursing event last fall with legal action. They failed. They tried again this year. Under Kansas law, a permit is required to use animals for sport and slaughter. The Greyhound Association had no such permit. The local judge, Tom Nold, seized upon a legal technicality and ruled that no permit was necessary. In Judge Nold's opinion, Kansas law protects only Kansas rabbits. The rabbits used in this meet were brought in from out of state. This is where most of them come from, the oil country of western Texas. From here, the jackrabbits are shipped all over the country, tens of thousands of them, destined to meet the dogs in both legal and illegal greyhound coursing events. The going price for the jacks is just $6 apiece, and one of the biggest rabbit merchants around is a farmer named Jess Allen. Allen and his family own a 740-acre farm just outside the small Texas town of Big Springs. He's one of the principal suppliers to the Kansas and other coursing events. He didn't want to talk with us about it. 2020's Charles Thompson and the Humane Society's Franz Donsler posed as greyhound owners from Tennessee in the market for rabbits. Allen went for it. The camera crew and I waited in a field across from Allen's farm. 6 hours later, Allen's hunters brought in 36 jackrabbits. He also told us what to do in order to ship the animals out of Texas. You need a health certificate, since wild rabbits frequently carry diseases infectious to humans. Allen sent us to Dr. Henry Tillett. The next morning, Thompson and Dantzler took the jacks to Tillett's office. The examination consisted of a casual glance at two of the 33 rabbits we had purchased. The doctor never removed them from their caged boxes. He did give us the health certificate. Charge, $3. The next stop was the Midland-Odessa Airport. Allen had advised us that we could ship the rabbits from here. By labeling the crates for eating purposes only, they can be shipped virtually without limitations. Texas International Freight Clerk, Kim Lewis.
They ship them to these guys and they use them to train the greyhound with chasing.
What different states do they ship them to?
They ship them all over the country, South Dakota, Sioux City, Iowa, all over the place.
Doing a story about the greyhounds. That's why we were interested in information. Oops. How about that, Mr. Allen, he ship a lot of
rabbits? Like I said, I think he goes to Continental mostly.
Records obtained from Continental and Texas International Airlines showed that rabbits are being shipped to at least 40 different states, including many where coursing is not permitted. Florida and Kansas are the largest consumers. We never shipped our rabbits. We took them out to some range land and set them free. Coursing is specifically outlawed in England, Australia, and in 6 states of the Union because it's considered inhumane. Many other states have general anti-cruelty laws that might protect the rabbits, but the laws have not yet been tested. Under federal law, animal fighting ventures, such as dog or cockfighting, are expressly prohibited. According to the Department of Agriculture, the agency empowered to enforce the animal welfare law, coursing is not an animal fighting venture and is therefore not covered. Dale Schwindemann is the head vet of the USDA.
in the technical sense, it's not two animals fighting each other.
Are you suggesting that coursing would come under the purview of the USDA if the rabbit put up a better fight?
No, I'm not saying that it would come under USDA if the rabbit put up a better fight. What I'm saying is that the two animals involved are not there for the specific purpose of fighting.
It seems more...
it's a technical...
It's a technical cop-out, technical. It seems, Doctor, with all due respect.
When 2020 brought the existence of public coursing events to the attention of Kansas Senator Robert Dole, he responded by introducing a bill to prohibit the practice.
Well, I proposed, today, that we outlaw public coursing, that we prohibit the shipment in interstate commerce of rabbits to be used in public coursing, and we also prohibit intrastate use of wild rabbits for public coursing. If you do it for a second or a minute or an hour, it's an act of inhumanity, cruelty, and it ought to be stopped.
A more far-reaching bill is being proposed this week by Senator Birch Bayh of Indiana. While the Dole bill outlaws only public coursing events, Bayh's bill would prohibit any inhumane use of wild animals by the greyhound industry.
Geraldo, do you really think there's going to be legislation growing out of this?
I hope so. Congress, of course, has a lot of more profound things to consider, but this is one of those petty barbarisms. I hope they get around to passing the law. Bayh's bill, incidentally, will be introduced tomorrow.
Thanks, Geraldo.
Next, how Flip Wilson turned Geraldine out of the house to take in his own kids.
...2020 is brought to you by the American Express card. Don't leave home without it.
Do you know me? When I travel with my cats, people recognize me. But without them, they don't. So I carry the American Express card. Now airlines and shops in Germany and France all over recognize me as someone deserving first-class treatment. And believe me, it's easier to carry this than this.
To apply for a card, look for this display wherever the card is welcomed.
The American Express card. Don't leave home without it.
We took the taste, the great taste of Michelob, and made a light beer.
It's Michelob Light. There is no doubt. This is what light beer is all about. Good taste.
Good taste.
Like Michelob Light runs in the family. Good taste runs in the family.
Yeah.
Words, arcane, mysterious, secret, obscure.
That's the way we're used to seeing Flip Wilson, funky, funny, and outrageous. But Flip dropped out of show business 5 years ago, and we wondered why. His marriage had broken up, and he'd taken custody of three of his four kids. We caught up with him and his children at his home in Malibu.
I gave up the show at that time because I had just acquired custody of my children. I discussed this with the children's mother, and I wanted the children here so they could make the next step in their growing up. It was her preference to stay in Florida, so there was no disagreement as to what was best for the kids. I came from a large family. I went through a series of foster homes and farm schools, and I know what it was like. And I feel that if women are gonna be liberated, then men must liberate themselves also. So I felt that if a woman could raise a few kids working herself a few days a week, I know that with the means that I had, that I would be able to raise these kids. I'm extremely proud of the children. They are my best friends. But I think that the two most gratifying points are when I first received custody of Tammy, her hair was in a very short natural. And I've always felt that a woman's hair was a beauty. And I've nursed her hair along very much. I've always been concerned about the girl's hair. And I'm very pleased with where their hair is now from where it was at that time, which was a very short natural. Isn't that correct? I will go up a wall about their hair. My next biggest thrill is... watching her mature. Watching her become more feminine. Watching her concern about... Watching her breasts grow. And watching her asking where's the bubble bath. And things like that. Of the four, I spanked you once, right? And I spanked you twice. And I was wrong both times. I don't think I've ever spanked you, have I?
You have.
I have?
Once, I think.
Well, what was that for?
For putting a lot of salt on Terry's eggs.
That's right, for putting a lot of salt on her eggs. That's right, I forgot I spanked her. But let me tell you what happened. When I get ready to spank one, I have the others there to judge. At the time when I got ready to spank this young lady, I waited till she went to sleep. And then I called the other kids and took them in the room. I said, I'm gonna spank her. And I woke her up and I told her that I'm gonna spank you. And each time that I hit you with the belt, it was a little thin belt, strap, I want you to repeat this line. That I will not do that again. I forget what it was. I think you'd slam somebody's hand in the door or something. What was that? I don't remember. It was something, well, anyway. So she said, okay, Daddy. So she pulled her pajamas down. So I hit her one time, she said the line, I won't do that anymore. So I hit her a second time, she said the line, won't do that anymore. So I hit her three times, she said the line, but she hadn't cried yet. So I'm wondering, why isn't she crying? So I hit her again, she said the line, and I'm still shook that she's not crying. And it concluded with her saying, Daddy, when is enough? And that was it. She never cried. I never spanked her again. She remembers. She remembers. You remember, don't you? I was so concerned with being a good parent that I might have pressed it more than I should have at the moment. And even in the case that I did, I made a mistake. I admitted it. But, and I think the tears just might reflect the fact that I could just not believe that they were that good. And they are.
Coming up next, a 2020 look at the chance of nuclear terrorism in this country.
And in some who've raised the possibilities.
If a bad accident happened at this factory, the worker would suffer, and the business. That's why one big manufacturer uses a loss prevention program the Hartford recommended. It helps make jobs safer by suggesting ways to prevent accidents. After 1 year, the Hartford's program helped reduce claims almost $100,000. And when losses go down, rates don't have to go up. Call an independent agent who represents the Hartford, because the best protection is prevention.
The more fun you have, the more fun you have when you play it back seconds later on your Polavision player.
What form? What a form.
Oh, when will I ever learn?
Good shot.
Polavision, the new instant movies from Polaroid. Oh! You could even learn a little bit about yourself.
Uh-huh.
How effective is ban roll-on?
I found out the week I went back to college for my class reunion. I remembered the yearbook, but forgot the ban roll-on. My old roommate offered me her secret aerosol, so I used it for a while. But you know, it just didn't keep me as dry as ban roll-on. I'm told ban roll-on keeps you drier than any leading spray. And I believe it.
Ban roll-on. If you're using any leading spray, find out for yourself how effective ban roll-on is.
Wednesday, Richard Dawson hosts the 5th annual Daytime Emmy Awards. It's a celebration of daytime, with your favorite daytime stars on hand to decide who's the best under the sun. And Thursday, you may get the best news of your life.
There's more than $20 billion in unclaimed money in the United States.
No matter who you are or where you live, you might be rich and not know it. Hal Linden will reveal whether you are a missing heir. Words, exegesis, critical explanation or interpretation.
This cloud has been on our horizon since 1945, when the atomic age began. We've known that war could trigger it, or an accident set it off, and the nuclear nations have done what they could to establish deterrence and to provide safeguards, in short, to balance the fear.
But what happens when the terror becomes terrorism, itself unbalanced? Blackmail by any means. It hasn't happened here, and one hopes that it never will. But to ignore the possibility is to deny the meaning of living within the nuclear age.
And what if the threat came down to one individual, a single terrorist, lone blackmailer, solo nut, now able to make his own bomb? The know-how's available, and the nuclear materials too often are somehow missing or unaccounted for in the official sources. And there have been such threats, as Sandra Vanocco reports.
You built a bomb. To prove how easy it was. Do you realize what they could do with an atomic bomb?
Building your own nuclear bomb. A fantasy on Spider-Man, but a reality to Joe Owen. In October 1970, at the age of 14, he threatened the city of Orlando, Florida with a nuclear device. Apprehended, Owen was given a suspended sentence, ordered to undergo psychiatric treatment. His inspiration was not television fantasy, it was science fiction.
They held a city for ransom. I believe it was a germ warfare that they used. But the more I read that book, the way the author came out and explained the feelings of the people at the time, at first they thought it was a prank. It was, you know, nobody could do this. And then he gave a test. I believe he wiped out a suburb or something. And then they took him serious. And I was thinking at the time, well, I want people to know it. I want everybody to know I know this. And I felt at the time that was the best way to get the point across.
Well, about 1 o'clock in the morning on that date, I was summoned to Mayor Carl Langford's office and was handed an envelope and a letter that was typed in red. It was purportedly from an unnamed organization who said they wanted $1 million or else they would use an atomic device that was in their possession to blow up the city of Orlando.
Nuclear energy always gave me an excitement inside. It's something that, to me, had great possibilities.
2 days later, we received another letter which showed an atomic device, and the writer challenged us to contact a nuclear physicist to verify this device, which we did. We contacted a young physicist at McCoy Air Force Base who said that all of the essential component parts were present.
The design I got basically out of books. They didn't say this is the way it is. They gave explanations of how it should work, why certain things happen. And sitting down, just thinking about it, I figured out in my own mind the only way I knew it could work and drew it from there.
The young man had said that this particular bomb was a dirty bomb because of the casings and the material, and that it had the potential of 50,000 pounds of TNT. Now, the nuclear physicist did not disagree with that.
The kind of explosive force that one could get from a crude nuclear explosive could blow up the Capitol, could blow up not only the White House, but houses and office buildings close to it.
Dr. Theodore Taylor, Princeton professor, former designer of nuclear weapons.
one person without any help from anyone else, using information that is public, using materials, except for high explosive, that could be gotten in any well-equipped hardware store, could put together, make a nuclear weapon.
You don't even need a nuclear weapon. What if somebody stole the used, highly radioactive material from a nuclear power plant and just right in the middle of a big container put two or three sticks of dynamite and set up on top of a skyscraper and just blew it out all over the city? It would contaminate the city with deadly radioactivity, which would be, there would be no blast effect because there were just the top of the building, say, would be blown off from the dynamite, but it would scatter the radioactivity all over the country, all over the city there, the wind would blow it. There'd be no way to pick it up. It would be so highly radioactive that you could not go up to it, and it would kill anybody there.
Bomb-grade materials could be stolen easily.
James Conran, official Nuclear Regulatory Commission.
If bomb-grade materials could be stolen, they could be used rather easily to make workable nuclear explosives.
How much highly enriched uranium is missing in the United States?
It's difficult to get an accurate figure, but estimates have been made as high as 8,000 pounds in the 20 years of our nuclear experience in this country. Now, translating into possible weaponry, that would come out with about somewhere 12 to 20 pounds needed for a nuclear weapon for a good design. You divide that out into 8,000, that makes an awful lot of potential nuclear weapons.
Senator John Glenn, Chairman, Senate Subcommittee on Nuclear Proliferation.
Well, I don't want to be an alarmist that scares people to the point where we think there's an atomic bomb under every bridge or in every building someplace, but we have had threats in this country, threats at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and these NEST teams, the teams that go out to investigate these threats. They found with sufficient evidence that they, in four or five cases, they've actually gone out and run full-blown investigations because they weren't really sure whether there really was a nuclear weapon.
NEST, Nuclear Emergency Search Team. Again, no television fantasy, not a scene from Mission Impossible. NEST's assignment, to aid authorities in locating nuclear material that may be employed in potential nuclear threats. The unit was created by the government after a nuclear extortion threat in Boston in May 1974. Donald Kerr, Department of Energy, describes that incident.
We started to try to assemble resources from all over the then AEC to respond. We actually staged people as far as Rome, New York, and they were not required to go further. The FBI, through its own police work, if you will, felt that it had determined that it was not a real nuclear threat.
Whenever the government decides it has a serious problem on its hands, it makes a training film. Scenes from a government film, based on a training search for a nuclear bomb in Idaho. A test of how quickly the NEST team could locate a similar bomb in a potential nuclear threat.
The EOD team prepared to emplace the destructive ice, a special shaped charge provided by the Los Alamos Scientific Laboratory. Upon approval by EACT, the destruct charge was fired in simulation, thus completing the exercise.
In this simulated exercise, NEST decided to detonate the bomb. In other cases, it might be possible to defuse the device.
November 4th, 1975. No training exercise. Los Angeles, California. Union Oil Company is threatened. Unless it hands over $1 million, a 25-kiloton atomic bomb will be set off at one of Union's facilities. NEST is called in, so is the FBI. Sebastian Mignosa, Chief Terrorism Section, FBI.
They told us that there was not, in fact, any special nuclear material in the area where the extortionist said it was. Making a long investigation short, we were able to determine who the person was. We located the person. He was subsequently convicted in court.
Thanksgiving weekend, 1976. NEST is again called into action. A threat note is mailed to the Spokane, Washington Police Department. $500,000 is demanded. But no nuclear material is found, nor the person or persons making the nuclear threat. That was the last time NEST was called in response to a nuclear threat. But government personnel, whether in Las Vegas, Nevada, or here at the command center in Germantown, Maryland, function as if another nuclear threat could come at any time.
How do you draw the fine line, as a United States senator responsible for this problem, between alarming the public and being alarmed?
Well, it's a fine line, as you indicate, and I don't think we've gone overboard on over-alarming the public. If anything, we've had trouble exciting anyone to do anything about it. We've been sort of a lone voice in the wilderness, I've felt sometimes here, talking about this problem that I felt was so important, and news people picking up very little on it. People don't get interested in what may happen in an atomic bomb situation 10 years from now or 5 years down the road, yet it's desperately important. And so I haven't felt we've alarmed anybody. If anything, we've had trouble getting people to be alarmed.
There's a nasty prospect, Sandy.
It's nasty, Robert, but I'm persuaded that the government is coming to grips with the problem. Albeit belatedly, as John Glenn said, it is coming to grips with the problem. In our next report, we're going to talk about how it's coming to grips with the problem and the serious disagreement within the government about how to deal with the problem. We're also going to be talking to a psycholinguistics expert, the man that the FBI turns to analyze the language of the threat to see if the threat is credible. And we'll be returning to Joe Owen for some more details on how he thinks it's very easy to build a crude nuclear device and how easy it is to transport that device around the country.
That's part two next Tuesday night. Thank you, Sander. We'll be talking later via satellite to California's political pop star, Governor Jerry Brown.
And we'll be right back with a 2020 profile of the governor.
Nowadays, I try to be more careful choosing medicines. Sometimes aspirin upset my stomach, so now I take Bufferin. Bufferin adds protection ingredients, and it's great for my headaches.
I'm more careful now. I tried Tylenol, but it doesn't provide me with an added relief action I want. Bufferin does.
In many cases, Bufferin provides both. An added relief action Tylenol can't, and protection ingredients Anacin and Bayer don't.
So now I take Bufferin, because I'm more careful.
I look everywhere. I find nothing.
Suppose you lose your wallet on vacation.
I've no cash, no credit cards.
You have nothing?
But what about your raincoat?
Good idea. Mario?
We have no money.
We got problems. What'll you do? What will you do? Rely on American Express traveler's checks. If they're lost, you can get a full refund at over 60,000 places. American Express traveler's checks. Don't leave home without them.
2020 will continue in a moment.
Ken Norton, Larry Holmes, the WBC World Heavyweight Championship Friday.
Those earphones, is that, are you listening to something else while we're talking?
That's Governor Jerry Brown campaigning small in 1976, but no longer. Tonight he's out to win big in the California primary, getting ready his best shot for 1980 to succeed Jimmy Carter.
I hate to think what would have happened to my own campaign had he been unleashed. For New Hampshire instead of Maryland.
So tonight on 2020, we're going to look at the chances of California's unleashing Jerry on Jimmy again.
Governor Brown's facing his first real crisis. Tonight, a tax reform that could cut California's revenues in half and, for himself, block the road to the White House.
We'll be talking to the governor himself via satellite, and also we'll have for you the results just in of a 2020 poll taken nationwide about Brown's chances against Carter in 1980.
But first things first, what kind of governor has Jerry Brown been for the 3.5 years he's held office? For a politically unfriendly view, we'll go to Sacramento and to Sylvia Chase.
I'm speaking to Assemblyman Frank Lanterman, who's held public office in California for 28 years under five different governors. Now, suddenly, he's about to quit. Why? Mr. Lanterman, what is it with Governor Brown? Is he a bad leader or what?
No, I presume it's his superficial approach to reality, to the extent that if he can make a catchphrase or something that will attract people's attention, that's sufficient for the time being. We call him the gay troubadour of rhetoric and whatever you want to call him.
Are you saying that he's all rhetoric?
Well, let me quote him. After taping an anti-crime commercial during his 74 gubernatorial campaign, he said, "Buzzword, buzzword, 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 buzzword." That ad had six buzzwords in it. It sounded tough, and I haven't proposed anything the liberals can criticize me for. In fact, I haven't committed myself to anything at all.
To put the paralysis and the malaise and the confusion behind us, to bring in a new generation to Washington, to try to recapture both the imagination of the people at home and also abroad.
All they are is sparkling rhetoric to attract attention, a glitter that is not gold, I can assure you.
Well, that's one California politician's view, but back in the East, Brown's ways, from Zen Buddhism to spending leisure hours with rock stars, have raised other doubts. Is he, quote, California weird, unquote? Well, here's Dave Marish to put that question to Jerry's sister, Mrs. Kathleen Brown Rice.
This sounds about as commonplace and regular as one man's family. Given that, why is it that is Jerry Brown weird has become an issue, not just in this, but consistently through his campaign? Why is it that people think that your brother's weird?
Well, he is unusual.
Is he weird?
Are you weird? Am I weird? I think it's, the way in which you look at things. It says as much about the beholder as it does about the individual being described. He is not usual.
Your brother used to end every debater's argument with the same statement. What we need, he would say, is a flexible plan for an ever-changing world.
Well, it used to drive me wild when I was 7 years old in 1952, and he would say that. When I wanted to win an argument, and he'd say we'd have to have an ever-changing plan for
a... Isn't there something intellectually dishonest about a statement like that?
No.
Isn't that sort of like saying we've got to have an evening after a morning?
No, that's true, isn't it?
Yes, but that's the essence of tautology, that it be true, but not meaningful.
I'm not so sure that you can pick apart one comment or one phrase or one bon mot of a politician and characterize then the being as hypocritical or nonsensical. I think that there is a method to his madness.
Sander Van Oker is with another member of the Brown family, one who has never run for public office.
Mrs. Brown, politically speaking, your son Jerry is not exactly a chip off the old block in terms of what his father stood for in politics, is he?
No, he has some of his qualities, but after all, he has some of my genes in him, too, so it's a little bit of each of us, I think.
Do you want your son to be president?
I have mixed emotions about it. I really have. And, well, I'll just leave it that way.
But Jerry Brown is also his father's son, different as they may be from each other. So I went to see former Governor Pat Brown in his law office.
Governor, if your son decides in 1980, assuming he wins this year in California, to run for the presidency, what would be your advice on his strategy?
Well, my advice at the present time, and probably in 1980, that he not run. He's young. I think all presumption should be in favor of the incumbent president. And I just don't think that a Democrat can win if you defeat the incumbent president. I think that President Carter's had very difficult problems to deal with. I think he's only been in office 15 or 16 months. Let's give him a little time.
I don't think any of you have any doubt that if I went to the White House, and assuming I moved in, it'd be a very different place than it is today. That I promise.
Next, we'll be talking via satellite with Governor Brown himself to ask if now he's ready to move in.
You know, buying insurance can really be a puzzle. So Fireman's Fund has a suggestion on how to solve it. Just look for someone who works for you, who chooses from several companies to get the best policy and price. In short, look for the sign of your independent agent. Because for insurance that's just right for you, there's no puzzle he or she can't solve. In the Yellow Pages, Fireman's Fund Insurance Companies.
We took the taste, the great taste of Michelob, and made a light beer.
It's Michelob Light. There is no doubt. This is what light beer is all about. Good taste.
Good taste.
Like Michelob Light runs in the family. Good taste runs in the family.
Yeah. When was the last time you tasted really good seafood?
Come on into Red Lobster. We've got plenty.
Super shrimp.
Tender fillets.
Beautiful lobster.
Over 30 different delicious choices prepared just the way you like. And priced to keep you coming back for more. For lunch, for dinner, for seafood, you know where to go.
Red Lobster is where America goes for seafood.
Tonight, on Late Night, the show of the year is back.
Hello.
It's the comedy hit of the year.
It's true.
It's so.
I like it, Mary.
And you're gonna love it on Late Night. So.
Watch tonight here on ABC.
Good evening, Governor Brown.
Good evening. How are you tonight?
Fine, thank you. Governor, your victory tonight seems assured, but your larger political future remains an open question. In 1976, you said, if I went to the White House, it would be a very different place than it is now. We wonder now, in 1978, what you mean by that.
My own view of what is important for the country goes very much to the heart of what we're all about, and I think the limits that I said government has to face, the frugality in government, the elimination of the frills, the long-term examination that is required to protect our environment, to make sure that we do have the alternative energies,
could I ask
the different
you, sir,
role throughout the world that I envision for the country. Those are all things that I talked about in 76, although I have to say tonight those things seem very remote to me.
People do tend to think ahead, Governor, and we here have done a national poll, a sampling tonight, which is intended to measure your chances against Jimmy Carter for the Democratic nomination in 1980. And the results came out as 49% of the sampling for Carter, 32% for yourself, and 19% uncommitted.
Are you heartened by this news, Governor?
Well, I think that gives me full authority to focus here in California. Obviously, people often say, give a flat no or a Sherman-like statement, and I try to be a little more honest because I've heard politicians say one thing and just change their mind. But I can honestly tell you, this evening, the furthest thought from my mind is Jimmy Carter and the White House.
Does that
mean we're facing the most massive property tax revolt, a major change in the way government does business, and that is my principal interest, managing that transition between what has been the government in California to what it must be after this initiative passes.
It does seem to represent a national trend, and do you believe that legislation in future is going to be going the way of Proposition 13?
I think that the sense that the public sector, the collective mechanism of government has been getting out of hand, that's certainly the feeling, that's the spirit that I hear spreading across the country, starting in California and moving east.
Governor, one last personal question about your political future. Earlier, your father told us he didn't think you should run in 1980. Now, I know that you haven't announced your intentions, but how do you feel about this parental advice coming your way with respect to a question that many of us are curious about?
Well, as I contemplated this evening, it sounds like very good advice to me.
Thank you very much, and good evening, Governor Brown.
I wonder how the other fellow feels.
He's still got the job, Hughes.
Yeah, but there you are, Hayes, those polls, those politicians. How he must long for the antique simplicities of the peanut and the loblolly.
We've got just the thing for a change of pace, a little fun.
Georgia, Georgia, the whole day through, just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind. I said, Georgia, Georgia, a song of you comes as sweet and clear as moonlight through the pines. Other arms reach out to me, other eyes smile tenderly, still in peaceful dreams I see the road leads back to you. Whoa. Georgia, no peace, no peace I find, just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind. I said just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind.
When I've got to catch a leader like Ben Crenshaw, I count on my Canon AE-1. It's fully automatic, so I can concentrate on my subject. Yet it's one automatic camera that's made to meet the strictest professional standards. Try it, Ben.
Are you kidding?
The AE-1 is so easy to use, you know you won't miss a shot. About all you do is focus and click.
The surprisingly affordable Canon AE-1. So advanced, it's simple.
You know, for years we burned in this symbol, the fire hat of Fireman's Fund. But here's an even more important symbol to burn in. To the people who sell our insurance, the independent agents. Each represents several companies, so they work for you to get the best policy and price. Naturally, we hope your agent picks Fireman's Fund, but make sure you pick an agent with this sign and you won't get burned. In the yellow pages, Fireman's Fund Insurance Companies.
Today is the 10th anniversary of Robert Kennedy's death. He's buried at Arlington. The family gathered for a memorial service there tonight. Senator Kennedy spoke to ABC's Sam Donaldson after the ceremony.
Oh, beautiful portrait, the dream that sees beyond the years.
They gathered on the hillside on this lovely spring evening at Arlington Cemetery to remember Robert Kennedy. His wife and children were there. And other members of the family, including Jacqueline Onassis, were there, along with a number of his friends. They sang and prayed and heard Mass. And afterward, Senator Edward Kennedy talked about his brother.
I remember him as a brother and the good times we spent together. I remember him, obviously, as a father, and those are probably the most powerful memories. But I think today there was the sense of hope and spirit that was both the private and the public person that out here this evening, and I think the people that have been inspired by him and who continue to work in the things that he worked on.
A lot of us live and die and never make an impact for good or evil, but most people think that wasn't true about your brother.
Well, I don't. I think he today, if you'd asked, name the things that you really have done, I think he would have felt that he made some impact. And that he believed deeply that individuals can make a difference. not that you necessarily move mountains, but that you move molehills and you change tides.
You know, in a sense, a lot of people, I think, remember him as a man on the thin edge of crisis. There was the committee, and there was the racial problems of the early 60s, Cuban Missile Crisis, his opposition to the war in Vietnam. He always seemed to live right there on something that was happening. It was almost a crisis in the country.
I think he was challenged by life, but I think the other side of that was that he liked to challenge people to be better than themselves. I think that applied to himself, and I think the people that he touched.
Do you think the country would have been better than it is today if he had lived?
Well, certainly my life would have been, and his children's lives, but I think he's the most important thing is that people felt that he did make some difference in touching their lives, and because of that, they want to improve the lot of others, and I think that's really the perhaps the most important thing about today.
The Kennedy brothers. Some lives do make a difference. Gentlemen.
And so until next week, I'm Harold Hayes.
And I'm Robert Hughes.
See you next Tuesday.
Courage. We're all in it together.
2020 has been brought to you by Fireman's Fund Insurance and your nearby independent agent. Fireman's Fund. For good protection, you'll never find a better place to hang your hat.
And that's the way it is. Tuesday, June 6th, 1978.
Sunday.
Hello, Mrs. Robinson.
It was 1968, and there'd never been a year quite like it. The war in Vietnam. The campaign. The promise. The despair. 1968, a crack in time.
Sunday on ABC.